has been a lot of schism in the Anglican Communion. There has been a lot of schism in the Episcopal Church of the United States. There has perhaps even been a certain amount felt more locally. And then on a local level, I know a number of things occurred prior to my arrival here 3 years ago, which, by the way, I want to thank you from the bottom of my heart for 3 wonderful years and many more to come. And during my time, we have seen a certain amount of turbulence. Mostly twice we have been in a position where really our immediate survival was somewhat questioned. Thanks be to God, we are not in that position at this point. But there's been a certain amount of wind, earthquake, and fire. And I wonder if right now, this very moment, this very summer that's unfolding in front of us, we have the opportunity to have that moment where we listen to the sound of sheer silence. Now, I know that doesn't sound terribly exciting, but perhaps not so exciting as is good news. And in that not so exciting moment of listening to the sound of sheer silence, perhaps we can hear, at a level of depth we have not yet plumbed, the voice of God telling us, what's next? So the question is, what might we be hearing in that space of sheer silence? Well, if what we're hearing is at all modeled upon what Elijah heard, it's going to be a relatively incomplete set of instructions. It's not going to be crystal clear marching orders saying, as you construct a strategic ministry plan, which, by the way, will be the work of our church's task force, here's exactly what you're going to do. Here's the measurable outcomes you're going to have after 1, 3, and 5 years. Ultimately, we will get there. But I don't think that's what we're going to hear at the very first. I think we're going to hear something a little bit more mysterious, a little bit more sublime. And my guess is it's going to be a call to live even more fully into the beautiful words that we just heard Charity read from Paul's letter to the Galatians. The fact that we are meant to all be one, no matter who we are, no matter where we came from, no matter what gender or race or any other classification we may belong to, we are all to be one in Christ Jesus. Now we hear that all over the pages of the New Testament. It's a beautiful ideal, but what even discerning what it means, let alone living into it, is a tremendous challenge. 2,000 years of church history, a brief glance will tell you that. Well, it clearly doesn't mean that we're all on the same page about everything. This is an ideologically very diverse church. You see that even on its surface, and now that I've been here for 3 years and had the blessing of having many one-on-one or small group conversations with many of you, I realize that beneath the surface, that's even more true. So clearly, this oneness in Christ Jesus is not meant to, in any way, make us all of the same mind or erase our differences. So it must mean a different form of oneness, that is oneness nonetheless. Now, I don't know if I can quite describe in words what that looks like, but I think I can outline an action that helps us get there more fully. And that action is have the guts to say the thing that the other person you imagine doesn't want to hear. Now, it's not really my business to meddle in your affairs with one another, although, as the spiritual leader of a parish, I can encourage certain things. But when it comes to your interaction with me personally, I think it's fair for me to make a direct ask. A couple of things came to my attention this past week. One was that I began tabulating the surveys, or not began, but continued, I'd already begun, that you so graciously have turned in over the last several weeks. And by the way, if you still haven't done yours, it's not too late. Ask me or somebody on the vestry during coffee hour and we'll get you a copy. But we're up now to, I'd say, 50, 60% of the regularly attending members of the parish. And an interesting result is coming. Our regular Sunday worship is overwhelmingly your first priority. This did not surprise me at all. And then things like pastoral care, education, prayer, things of that sort were the other ones that ranked quite high. Things that look a little bit more outward, things that you would put in the evangelism or the mission and outreach category, generally ranked somewhat lower. Now, the difference between those is not as large as it was when we used a similar tool 2 years ago, but it's definitely still there. And the reason that caught me up a little bit is because it's very different from what I get in face-to-face conversations. In face-to-face conversation, I get tremendous encouragement for ministry and outreach and mission and ecumenical and interfaith gathering. Which, by the way, I don't think anybody in here thinks that's unimportant, but the surveys indicated that you definitely want to make sure that the home team is still taken care of. And it makes me wonder if perhaps there's a level of reticence to say out loud, hey Andy, hey St. Mark's leadership, we'd like a little bit more pastoral care. We'd like a little bit more attention given to the affairs that most directly affect the regularly attending congregation of this church. And what I'm here to tell you is there's nothing whatsoever wrong with that. If that is your feeling, that is your feeling, and God is speaking in you and through you. If that's what you're thinking when you're asked what are the most high priorities of life here in this church. But one place it gets a little challenging is if somebody has to guess that that's how you're feeling. So if for any reason you are reticent to say that, my encouragement to you is gently move past that reticence. Nobody is going to bite your head off for saying what you truly believe and what you truly feel, least of all me. If you have ever had the experience of coming to me with a criticism or a suggested course correction, and I have not received it gracefully and in good faith, and to the best of my ability even acted upon it, I want to hear about that. Because that means I am not living in to my call to be your pastor and priest. And the other thing that caught me was, last Sunday I gave a sermon, many of you were there, over at the parish hall in the Center for Spiritual Living joined us. And it's come to my attention, I said a few things that caught some people up. Perhaps you interpreted it correctly, you just didn't like what I said. Perhaps you didn't interpret it the way I meant it. But either way, some people didn't like it, but I heard about this indirectly. Please don't, and I didn't hear any names, don't worry, nobody's gossiping, but I just knew that there were some issues that gave people pause. Again, it's awfully nice to get compliments on a sermon. I remember one of my seminary professors saying, nice sermon, Father, means nothing, but pity my poor dog the day no one says it to me. But the comments that actually are far more useful are the ones where you say, this piece really spoke to me and uplifted me. This piece, not so sure about that piece, is downright offended me. That is far more useful. And again, folks, my skin is not that thin. I can take it and I want it. It is the only way we grow as a community. So, in this summer where, God willing, we'll have a chance to listen to God's sheer silence and grow into greater oneness as a community, please consider this first of many summer sermons to be a direct act.